I hope everyone's having an amazing Christmas morning. I figured we'd use this time to do a little bit of a This Day in History for December 25th. And I got a lot of stuff I want to dive into because December 25th is very important when it comes to Transformers. There's a lot of stuff that happened during that time. And it's a big list, and I want to kind of just go through all of it and all the little aspects related to this special day. And it's not just about getting Transformer toys as presents and everything like that. I just want to also reiterate that tomorrow and probably on the 26th and 27th of December, there probably won't be a segment. Jaws D is going to be coming down, and we're going to be doing all kinds of recording and stuff like that for our big top five Transformers of 2019 and best Transformer of the past decade. So I'm not going to be putting out any new segments over those past 2 days. If there's some kind of big news, just bear with me. We will get around to it. I just suggest, number one, just enjoy the free time with your family, if anything. Or if you're a Canadian and it's the 26th, go Boxing Day shopping. There's probably going to be a lot of deals and stuff. What I also could suggest is, because it's the 25th today, if you want, I'll link in the comments below. Me and Jaws D did a segment, I want to say it was a year ago, where we talked about some of the best presents we ever got as Transformer fans, Transformer-related presents. So you can listen to that segment, and that'll be a kind of a good topical refresher, if you will, to fill in the gap until we come back afterwards. So let's do This Day in History, December 25th. Now, I broke it down into categories. First one I want to talk about is people that were born on December 26th, the unlucky people that were born on December 25th and have to deal with sharing a birthday and Christmas at the same time. So you kind of lose out on presents unless you're one of those lucky kids that somehow their parents just said, no, we'll give you double the presents. So comic letterer Joe Rosen was born 1920 on December 25th. And he's best known as one of the most prolific Marvel comic book letterers. A lot of people in the industry, before they kind of moved to computers doing it, Joe was the guy who did lettering for practically everything in Marvel. And even Richard Starkings, who was one of the letterers in the UK, went on to say, you know, once I got over being impressed by flashy or more stylized letterists, I quickly realized that Joe Rosen held the bar, which we all tried to leap over, because he was like the standard Joe Rosen when it come to lettering. And I know it sounds silly, but I figure we'd use him to celebrate. And what did he work in Transformers related? Again, Marvel, he did practically everything. But when he did do the Transformers brand, he was responsible for the lettering in G.I. Joe versus Transformers, the original Marvel 80s one. So if you want to kind of check out his lettering and see what all the buzz was about, check out that in relation to Transformers. We also have Ron, and I apologize if I screw up his name, Batita. Ron Batita was the voice of Roadbuster in the Dark of the Moon movie. So, yeah, the character of Roadbuster, John Batita, also born 1960, December 25th. Now, let's go into some people who passed away. And again, this one is someone that I really enjoyed, some of his stuff in relation to Transformers. The artist Art Welrell, he passed away December 25th, 2003. Outside of Transformers, he was known for working on the Death's Head comic in the UK, and of course did a lot of work with Dark Horse's Star Wars stuff and the Star Wars comics they did during all of the 90s. But what he's known for is he did a bunch of covers in the UK for Transformers issues 191, 196, 216, and 257. He did a lot of full art stuff like Trigger Happy. But what he's best known for, and something that I really liked, was he actually was the penciler for Aspects of Evil, specifically Part 2. And that was kind of the story of when Unicron was kind of influencing the Matrix and as a result was influencing Rodimus. And I don't want to spoil it too much. It's a really good story. I heavily suggest you try to track it down and read it. It's kind of like, it's one of these like after the war kind of stories and just how like the war really never ends. There's always conflict. And I just want you to like, you know, go try to track down Aspects of Evil. It was a UK exclusive story. And again, Art Witherell did a really good job penciling it. It looked really cool. Let's jump into mangas, because there wasn't really any comics that came out on Christmas Day, but there was a few mangas in Japan that did. Two specific ones I just want to point out. December 25th, 2006 was the debut of the SparkBots Volume 1 for the Teletran 15 Go Go manga. That was kind of like the sequel manga to Kiss Play. And so this was the debut of the SparkBots, which were these three old Microman Daiklon Transformer balls that transformed. They were repainted, brought over for the Kiss Play line, and they had this huge, like, you know, dark secret story and stuff like that, where they were kind of working for Unicron. So pretty cool stuff. Spoiler. They've never been translated, unfortunately, so might as well fill you in on those. And then in 2010, Caro Caro Ace magazine published the very last issue of Transformers Zakuul. Transformers Zakuul, or The Cool, was the manga version of the Transformers animated series, and it was the last issue of that series, although oddly enough, the following weeks, the demand for more was so prevalent that they went on to make three more special issues afterwards. Now, and by the way, the art was done by Nato-san, who is an amazing artist in the Transformer community from Japan. So definitely check that out if you get a chance. His art was incredible. Let's go into the toy world. Again, not much stuff debuted in, you know, America and Canada. We don't really have set dates for stuff to debut toy-wise, but in Japan, they're a little more good with that kind of stuff. So what debuted, essentially, Transformer-wise, on Christmas? Well, in 2010, of December 25th, was the debut of MPM-02 Masterpiece Bumblebee, the movie Bumblebee toy. And so that debuted, and that same day, also, they kicked off the United line. The United line was kind of like a little bit of what the direction of the Generations line was going to be doing in Japan, because at one point it was called Henkei, and then we had just, it was like, you know, we knew it for a long time afterwards as Legends, but at one point it was called United. And that's where kind of the Chug name comes too, because it's like, it's Universe, but it's United, but it's Generations, but it's Henkei, but it's Classics. So United debuted, and that had essentially, you know, mild repaints and silvery repaints of Optimus Prime from the War for Cybertron stuff, and then they also did repaints of some of the more older classic stuff like that, and they called it Earth Mode. But a lot of it was the War for Cybertron toys, along with the Drift toy from Generations and Straxus, which was called Straxus in Japan, but Darkbound still here. So that all debuted on Christmas, and that was the beginning of the United line for a bit, until it would get discontinued and Legends would come around with Sakamoto's stuff and the mangas. Now let's get into animations, the last part I really want to talk about. Now, when it comes to animation, oddly enough, actually, let's just mention, when it comes to stories of Christmas, Transformers, oddly enough, in animation only had one Christmas story, and it was animated, and it was the episodes Human Error Part 1 and 2 was actually the only Christmas episodes ever of Transformers. But oddly enough, those episodes debuted in April 18th, 2009, so we can't talk about those. Same thing, like all the Christmas issues of Transformers never actually came out on Christmas Day. They came out, you know, usually in December, but not on Christmas Day. And the UK had tons and tons of Christmas stories with the Transformer Marvel comics back in the day. I mean, like, just to name like a few, like there was, I want to say like, what was it called? Christmas Breaker was one of them, I think. There was Christmas Breaker. There was The Gift. There was Stargazing. That's the famous cover with Starscream going, "It's Christmas," and he going like, "Yeah, so what?" Cold Comfort and Joy, The Greatest Gift of All. Dreadwing Xmas, which is like Dreadwing, but he's getting visited by the ghosts of Christmas past, present, and future. Like, those were all amazing little UK stories. And so there was tons of those. But again, all of those didn't come out on Christmas Day. They came out, like, you know, in December, but not on Christmas Day, unfortunately. But what I want to, and I want to kind of do it backwards, is we'll talk about animation, because the last one I want to talk about will cap off all of this with this day in history, December 25th. So December 25th, 2010, the very last episode of Transformers Animated aired in Japan. We knew it as Endgame Part 2. Oddly enough, it was called Endgame. Endgame Part 2, the very last episode of Transformers Animated Season 3. But we got it a little earlier. And so Japan got it on Christmas Day. It was kind of their big goodbye, and the episode was called The Final Decisive Battle Suppress Megatron. Love Japanese titles for episodes of stuff. And, I mean, that was a big episode. That was a very big episode for a lot of people. But, again, Japan was kind of in December, like I just mentioned before, it was the end of the manga, so they were also ending the anime. It really was on its way out, unfortunately. So it kind of sucked, but, you know, Animated is what it is. It was one of the greatest Transformers series of all time. And then, of course, you know, Headmasters. So then we go like, okay, well, what about, let's jump into G1 here. So December 25th, you know, 1987, we had the Headmasters episode, Mystery of the Space Pirate Ship. Not much to mention about this episode. The biggest claim to fame that I could say about this episode, it was one of those to sell toys episode, if you will, really featured the Autobot and Decepticon clones. So if you ever really wanted to know more about those characters, they had a lot of screen time in those episodes. So December 25th, 1987, you got to learn about your Autobot clones and Decepticon clones. So maybe they were trying to get Japanese kids to buy some Autobot and Decepticon clones. They weren't selling well. And the last thing, the very last thing that let's talk about is on this day in history, December 25th, 1985, the episode War Dawn debuted. Now, War Dawn is that very famous episode that explained to fans the origin of Optimus Prime in this continuity of Generation 1, the animated continuity. The animated G1 continuity, not animated the series. Isn't that confusing? War Dawn showed us the story of a young Orion Pax looking up to these Decepticon characters that could fly, and he just wanted to be like them, and then he was betrayed by Megatron, shot, and then rebuilt by Alpha Trion into Optimus Prime. And there's almost it's almost funny, they debuted this episode on December 25th, and it's kind of like, you know, the rising, you know, of a new leader or something. And there's I wonder if there was almost that Jesus kind of allegory to, you know, like a lot of people joke that Optimus Prime is Space Jesus or Rodimus is Space Jesus. You know, he dies, comes back. Makes me wonder that if the episode War Dawn and the rebirth as, you know, Orion Pax into Optimus Prime, if there was some kind of connection there and if it was done on purpose. War Dawn would go on to be one of the episodes that would be cited for Transformers to be considered too violent for the air for some television stations in some countries, because War Dawn did feature a lot of death in it for a children's show. A lot of robots were killed. Alita, we never really see her rebirth or her rebuild, but she does get shot, and along with a lot of other characters. And so we never really get to see did they survive? I mean, we know ultimately in the end what happened and how she becomes Alita. Ariel gets shot. We don't see her become Alita 1 afterwards, but we all know that today. So, but it was one of those episodes that were cited for many years, like, oh, this is why Transformers needs to be taken off television. And I know that YTV in Canada at one point did take G1 off the air because of how violent it was considered at the time. Of course, you know, season 3 was already on its way out, so it wasn't, you know, wasn't too big of a deal anyways. Anyways, that being said, that was everything in this day in history in Transformers, December 25th. And I just hope everyone's having, again, a great holiday season. And next time you hear my voice or see my voice, it will be our special episode live. You will see our faces. You will see our bodies. Well, maybe, you know, if you don't want to see our bodies, but you will see us live and in the flesh, and we're going to be discussing everything. So be sure to get your voting in. Like I said before, go find that segment. It's only a couple of days away. And we're going to be doing our big top Transformers of 2019 and top transformer of the past decade. So Merry Christmas to everyone, happy holidays, and I hope to see you all very soon.